Welcome to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis, the birthplace of Congregational Humanism. We carry on that tradition of free thought today, dedicated to promoting a free search for truth, meaning, and justice. Our web address is firstunitarian.org. I'm David Breeden, Senior Minister. Welcome.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our weekly assembly for Sunday, August 29th, 2021. Some of us are present here in the Upper Assembly Hall at First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis. Some of us are present online via our various online platforms. Wherever you are, and whether this is one of your first visits or you've been with us many times, we are glad that you are here as a part of this gathered community. We hope that wherever you are, you'll join us for our online coffee hour shortly after the service ends. You can log in to the link that's in the chat window either now or a little later in the It will show up in the chat window either now or a little later in the service. And we look forward to seeing your faces in the Zoom room. Here are a couple of important updates. Assembly next week, September 5th, will be online only. Don't show up here at our building in person unless you want some contemplative time outside alone. After that, we shall see if it is safe to continue meeting in person. As we continue to follow news concerning the Delta variant, our reopening task force, the FUS board, and our staff are keeping our commitment to inclusion and consent front and center. We are following the science, yes, but also our values as we navigate these difficult days. The reopening task force will be meeting weekly to assess the numbers, especially the transmission rate in the metro area. And this is consistent with the Unitarian Universalist Association guidelines. Please, please keep an eye on the Friday email each week for the latest updates. That's where you'll find the information. And if you're not already on our email list, you can sign up for it on the homepage of our website. On this beautiful weekend day, with plenty of other ways to spend our time, we show up here. We attend to the life of this congregation, to our community, to the wider world. We listen, learn, grow, change, contribute, risk something of ourselves to imagine a future better than these present days that break our hearts open again and again. Let us be here now, and let us draw the circle wide. Come, be present as we gather in community.
Our life is chalice, remembering the First Unitarian Society aspiration.
We support one another's journey toward meaning and connection in the here and now.
And wherever you are, will you join me in the words of our congregational covenant? Love is the spirit of this place, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Special report from Retreat to the Woods. And the woods. and Cindy.
Like, bro, you really need to come to Retreat to the Woods. It's so much fun. Yeah, we go canoeing and hiking, and we hang out at the cabin and play apples to apples. Bro, you really need to come. It's totally cool.
I literally thought she was a teenager. This is the itinerary for the weekend. This is the lodge. Here's where we sleep. This is the inside of a cabin. It's quiet. It's fun. There's an outhouse. Some turkeys. You can go canoeing. Nature art. We get real close to nature on this weekend. Oh, and we also eat. And eat. Those are our chefs. And eat. And here's Michael.
My cooks at the upcoming October 1st through 3rd Retreat to the Woods. We are so excited to be able to have this event after missing out for a year. It's a lot of fun, a lot of activities for you, your friends, and your family. For my dinner on Saturday night, we'll be having caprese salad, stuffed shells with marinara sauce, meatballs, and awesome French bread.
I heard French bread with garlic. I can't get enough of these woods. Leaves changing color, playing in the lodge, reading, hanging out, having fun, learning. Here we're knitting, and here's some kids learning to knit. And a family. We love families at the retreat, and friends. And here, this is where you could take a walk by yourself, or you could recruit somebody to go with you. There's a lot of singing. And we hang out by the fire outside, make s'mores. We go on nature walks and find swans. When's the last time you saw a swan? The Retreat to the Woods is special. It's the first weekend in October. And you are invited. Please sign up today on the FUS website, or you can go to the table outside. We'll have more information there, and we really hope to see you there. It's been a long time, and we all deserve a retreat.
Good morning. This song is incredibly popular, but I bet most of you have never seen it in the show, because the show, Funny Girl, is not produced that often. It's actually not that great. But the song itself is fantastic because it comes at a point where this very successful in a monetary, in a fame, in a popularity way person finally comes to this realization in this song that that's not enough. That she has what many people would say is everything. And yet, she has nothing.
People who need people are the luckiest people in the world.
Since our founding in 1881, members and friends' support of First Unitarian Society has been essential for our ongoing mission. Our Sunday assemblies, community celebrations, cultural enrichment, and work in social justice come to you with the hard work of our dedicated staff and volunteers. Your contributions will help assure the continuing work of First Unitarian Society. Give now at PayPal, the Give Plus app, or firstunitarian.org/donate. Thank you.
On Sundays, when we gather, we take a few minutes to reflect on the joys, sorrows, and milestones of the human experience. We do this so that we stay in touch with our own humanity. We do this to remind ourselves of the value of a moment of stillness. And we do this so that no one among us is alone, either in celebrating joy or in facing the burdens of life. This morning, we have an update from FUS member Polly Peterson, who was in a hit-and-run automobile accident on Tuesday morning. Polly says she feels fortunate that she was unaware of anything until she woke up in the hospital after receiving emergency care. She had surgery to support her left knee on Wednesday and is wearing a neck brace, and she expects to move to rehab soon. Because of the pandemic, Polly is limited to 2 visitors a day, so people should not come, she says, but she welcomes cards and texts. We wish Polly well on her continued recovery and will be in touch with her about her upcoming needs. Also in our thoughts this morning is another longtime FUS member, Bill Weir, who is still hospitalized after complications from a fall and 2 strokes. Bill had another surgery this past week and will soon be moving to a care facility. We hold Bill and Patty and their families in our thoughts as they navigate the days ahead. If you need the caring bridge address for Bill, please let me know and we'll get that to you. And this morning, we also extend our thoughts to those facing peril in the wider world, the residents of Louisiana, who are facing a major hurricane barreling toward them as we speak this morning. We think of people of all nationalities in Afghanistan who are facing terrorism, violence, and great uncertainty. And we think of those in Minnesota and around the country who are living with the threat of smoke and fire. The human family and the earth that sustains us are hurting in so many places. Grief and anger are understandable. As the author and minister Nadia Bowles-Weber says, there is not a human heart on this planet that can bear all of what is happening right now. In these very hard times, may each of us find meaningful ways to help. May we find comfort in the small things, and may we find love and support in our communities. We now take a moment of silence to reflect on all the challenges and heartbreak going on in our lives and in the world. And with gratitude, we think of all those who are leading lives of justice, service, and compassion. Let us now share a moment of silence.
we grow up learning particular, specific ways of thinking. We learn these from the environment we live in, from our social situation. As General George Marshall phrased it long ago, he learned everything he knew at his mother's knee and other low joints. After we learn specific ways of thinking, they become habitual. And it takes effort to think outside of these habits. But as free thinkers and free formers, as Rev. Dr. J. Hooper insists we must become, we are committed to examining ways that we think. How do we think? And one way most of us have been enculturated is by thinking of knowledge as a tree. It is our metaphor for various kinds of knowledge. Let's get my slides up here, and you can see this good slithery snake. After all, one of our foundational stories in our culture is of Adam and Eve and their encounter with the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. We have family trees. We have phone trees. We have trees showing authority that we call flow charts. After you start thinking about it, we have a lot of trees in our minds. And we don't see the trees because our culture says it's a forest of thought. But unlike the actual trees out there that help us breathe fresh air, these mental trees can be oppressive. Two French philosophers, Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, in a pair of books together titled Capitalism and Schizophrenia, yes, how do they feel about capitalism, set out to change our way of thinking away from this hierarchical process. And I'm going to play a 3-minute theory for you, and you too can subscribe to this on YouTube.
The rhizome is a concept developed by Deleuze and Guattari that can be defined as an A-centered multiplicity. Wait, what? What does that mean? Okay, multiplicities can be understood as neither subject nor object, only magnitudes and dimensions that can't increase in number without changing in nature. Take temperature, for example. 80 degrees Fahrenheit has a certain feeling to it. Any adding or subtracting of degrees results in a different feeling. Compare that to, say, adding or subtracting from a bag of marbles. Whether you add to it or take from it, it's still a bag of marbles. This is a quantitative difference versus a multiplicity, which is more of a qualitative difference. So anyway, that's a multiplicity, and while a rhizome is just a bunch of multiplicities put together in a way that has no structure at all. So why is the concept of the rhizome useful? Well, to think with it is to unveil the many ways that you can approach a thought or activity, helps question hierarchies and binaries, and provides us with a way to see how everything can be multiple and interrelated. To illustrate this concept, let's compare a tree with ginger. First, imagine a tree with roots extending into the ground, a trunk coming up out of the ground, and branches that go into the sky. Thinking has been historically imagined like this, based on the idea of hierarchies and categorizations. Much of Western philosophy stems from this thinking and can be seen in the structure of our schools, corporations, and even things like child development theories. All of these present a beginning, which is at the bottom, and one desired end to meet at the top. Where the tree is rooted in logical, ginger growth really doesn't make any sense at all. It has no top or bottom and goes off in every which way. Deleuze and Guattari describe 6 characteristics of the rhizome. Notice how they fit the image of ginger. Connectivity and heterogeneity means that any point can be connected to any other, no matter how similar or different. Multiplicity, remember temperature. A signifying rupture, which means the rhizome can be broken off at any point, but it'll always start up again. And cartography and decalcomania, which makes us think of the rhizome as a map, something that's always open and can be entered at any point. Think about it. Is there really a starting point to reading a map? What these six characteristics help us see is that the rhizome is not just a thing, but probably more of a process, an imminent process that allows us to question hierarchical organization. The rhizome's emphasis is not on what is or what was, but more on what can become of it. Some other illustrations of rhizomes might be the internet, especially a website like Wikipedia, or crabgrass. These things don't have a central root, origin, or logical pattern to their growth. These examples and their rootlessness help us envision how we might oppose what has been called rational approaches to knowledge. To think with the rhizome is to give up, at least for a little, beginnings and endings, tops and bottoms, and that comfortable shade of the tree. Because remember, rhizomes are always in the middle and suggest ways of rehabilitating thought as a creative and dynamic enterprise, where things aren't just this or that, but always and.
And no, we don't have their reading list, but you can definitely subscribe to 3-Minute Theory and can from there find out lots and lots of stuff. Well, this all sounds very abstract and philosophical, perhaps, but non-hierarchical ways of thinking and searching have become part of our lives. Now, they published this book in 1980 before the advent of the World Wide Web. And that's one of the reasons people are watching their ideas these days, because they were thinking way down the road. You get on the web, you start searching for this sort of thing, and wherever you end up, that's fine, and you're going to learn things along the way. And maybe it will change your way of thinking. Deleuze and Guattari contrast between aberrescent thinking. They are French philosophers, after all, so, you know, bear with them. But it's tree-like, hierarchical, and vertical thinking. And then aberrescent, rhizomatic thinking that is non-hierarchical and horizontal. So basically, vertical, horizontal, but also thinking of that tree that is rooted but goes up to the sky, so there's always an up, instead of that rhizome where it's always over and over and across and across and across. Now, I'm not talking about real trees here. Real trees are wonderful. I'm talking about the tree that's been planted in your head, whether you have noticed it or not. It is up there, and, God, CEOs, white men, somebody is up there, maybe, telling you that they are up there. Well, Deleuze and Guattari say, don't listen. Whether up there is heaven or Washington, D.C., or a corner office somewhere, don't listen. Think for yourself. Alcoholics Anonymous is a very famous rhizomatic model. That's why it's in almost all the church basements in the United States. It is non-hierarchical. You can start your own chapter. Black Lives Matter follows the rhizomatic organizational model. Community organizers follow the rhizomatic model. As a matter of fact, nowadays we talk about leaderless revolutions and leaderless protests. That is rhizomatic, and guess what? You can't arrest just one person. It's a way of thinking that is antithetical to hierarchy, centralization, and paternalism. Now, one book on this topic came out a few years ago is The Starfish and the Spider, The Unstoppable Power of Leaderless Organizations. Yes, the rhizomatic one is the starfish. Also, there's a famous one called The Cathedral in a Bazaar, Musings on Linux and Open Source by an Accidental Revolutionary. This was a book in the old days, and now it's online and keeps expanding. Another, by the same author, principal author as The Star and the Fish and the Spider, is The Chaos Imperative, How Chance and Disruption Increase Innovation, Effectiveness, and Success. A current New York Times bestseller is Call Sign Chaos by Mad Dog Jim Mattis, a Marine four-star general, Secretary of Defense for about 10 minutes, right? Mattis talks in that book about the Marines and how their decisions are best when they are done rhizomatically. You don't think of the military as rhizomatic, but on the ground, it darn well better be. Now, why am I talking about all of this? Well, it's because of this. And I do want to thank FUS member Amanda Harrington for making this, by the way, because it wasn't easy. And take a good look at this flow chart for First Unitarian Society. From this chart, if you look closely, you will see at the top is the congregation, the members, you. You are the boss here. But even when we point out how it really is that members are in charge, it's easy for some to feel excluded or feel like a little tiny part or like essentially no part at all, especially people who are new to our community. How do you get in to this structure? And in any human organization, it's easy to develop situations like George Orwell warned about. All are equal, but some are more equal than others. That's what we want to avoid, is Orwellian thought. When you feel like that, think about the rhizome. The strength of the congregation is in each of you. Now, where I come from, one of the most pernicious plants in the Mid-South is kudzu. It is an invasive rhizome. And what makes kudzu mighty is exactly because it is a rhizome. No hierarchy, no beginning, no end. And yes, it can crawl right up a light pole and go right across the road on the wires. You can cut down a tree, but kudzu, Now, when it comes to you being a member of FUS, an ambassador for FUS, and of humanism, always think kudzu.
Thanks so much, Rev. David.
Very cool. Well, all this talk of trees and kudzu and all kinds of fun stuff makes me wonder. I'd invite each of you to take a moment to consider, reflect back on a time when you, possibly recently, maybe in the distant past, planted a tree, or helped someone else plant a tree, or stood by watching eating an apple while others planted a tree, or maybe even just sat on a park bench underneath the tree, enjoying it, a tree that was planted years and years ago. But whatever your interaction with the tree might have been, consider that time. Take a moment and make use of the senses that you may have had. And enter into that moment, fix that point in your mind, if you will. Remember the sun, possibly the heat of the sun on your skin, the smell of the soil as you're working with it, or as others are nearby. Take a moment to enter into and think of the sense of accomplishment after it was finished, the beauty that it produced, the air that it kicked back towards your way so that you could start breathing or continue breathing after the fact as it sort of paid its gratitude towards you for planting it in the first place. If it was a group effort, think of all those folks that worked alongside of you. Some digging, others holding a sapling, putting it down below, I don't know, watering and all that good stuff, some taking pictures, putting it on the gram, or whatever may have been. But consider, though, all the team effort, the collectivity, as you're putting that new tree in the ground and making it happen. Now that I think of it, as I think of it, most of my memories planting trees have been in a congregational context. Be it everyone coming together to beautify the campus, the grounds that that particular congregation, faith community, may have been residing on, or be it going out doing service projects, beautifying other folks' properties and whatnot, planting trees there. But that's most of my tree planting experiences have been in that congregational concept. But with all this talk of trees as a visual of organizational structure and hierarchy, as David got us started here, as we think of this, be it centralized or decentralized, as we think of all these trees, be it top down or ground up, I'd invite us to take a few minutes here for the remainder of our time this morning and to take a look, if you will, at the structure of our congregation through the lens of community. To consider it that way, here at First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis, this concept of community is literally written into our mission statement. It says there that we are a quote-unquote congregational humanist community. A congregational humanist community. Now, we often spend a lot of time here at FUS talking about the humanist part, right? And for good reason. That word humanist, that represents our shared values, such as those of ethical development, such as peace and social justice, such as empathy, global awareness, anti-racism, service and participation, and on and on and on the list goes. Our shared values. Our humanism. But another word that we might not hear emphasized quite as often around here is this word community. We are a community. I'd invite you to take a moment, if you would, take another moment now. For those who are able, I'd invite you to pivot in your seat, if you would. Take note of those around you by using your senses, be it by looking, be it by simply listening. Take a moment to pivot around you in your seat. Now do it right, pandemic responsible, masks on, but seriously, let's literally do this. Those of us who are able, I might feel a little awkward, but pivot in your seat, look around. For those of us who might not quite be able to do that exactly, or who are listening online, you know, maybe you have a room full of people wherever you're at. Maybe you're sitting by yourself. If that's the case, then simply imagine in your mind, recognize those around you in your humanist community, be it locally or globally, online or off. But for those of you who are in this room and able to look around, I would invite you, once again, continue doing that. No more eyes up here. Everybody turn back around, look at one another, okay? Make eye contact, wave, yes, give a thumbs up. Give a wave, give a now virtual high fives, or not virtual, but you know, distanced high fives. Yes, up in the balcony, I see you up there, high fives. Any guests here today who are like, wow, this is a weird crew? I take full responsibility. I'm the weird one, okay, and I'm not normally the speaker, all right? So blame me for all that you would like of it, all right? But take a moment to take in the fact that this is your community. Or at least that's the goal, anyway. Ask yourself, does it feel like community? Again, that's the goal, anyway. All right, that FUS would increasingly become, in the most real and genuinely possible ways, that it would be our community. Congregations are great. Congregations, like, come together and congregate for events. That's good. But community takes that a step further. It is rich, and it is warm, and it is together, and it is give and take. It is inherently participatory. Community. Now, there is much that could be said about community and about the work of community building. Much, much that could be said. As David, though, has already clarified today, we're really talking about organizational structure. We're talking about hierarchy, or rather the intentional lack thereof when it comes to hierarchy. We're not so much top-down, but rather ground-up, grassroots, right? And we're talking about the fact that in community, we are the ones. We are the ones that make things happen. We are the ones that get things done. We are there for one another. Community is found in the we, not the they. Now you might say, well, wait a minute, but what about the ministers? They do a lot too, right? Or maybe most. Yes, yes, and they are important. Even, yes, incredibly important, and we are incredibly grateful, all right? But, as David said just a moment ago, the congregation's the true boss. The congregation is the structure of our community, all right? And so maybe we could say that the job of the ministers, at least in a sense, at least from an angle, the job of the ministers is to foster, you could say, greater community, where we as the community members are then more fully empowered to play our roles more fully, more completely, more healthfully, more joyfully, more energetically, more emphatically. In the tree of community, we, each of us, we are the branches that stretch out and that interweave together to make the tree of community stronger, to make it more beautiful, to make it more life-giving, to make it more oxygen-rich, a greater home and sanctuary to all the world's creatures, the tree of community. That is us. And so really part of the question then here, as we consider our role in the structure of this community, is really twofold. One, how's my participation? Where is it now? And two, where would I like it to be as we continue to move forward and build as a congregational humanist community? I'll take a couple brief moments here to point us towards a 2017 article from the Mayo Clinic, right? The legendary, authoritative Mayo Clinic, right? Right nearby here, nearby the Twin Cities in Rochester, Minnesota. And in this article, it's discussing the health benefits of volunteering and of community participation. So just in case some of us might be a little hesitant towards all the warm and fuzzy tree of community, woo-woo, isn't that great? You know, maybe we want something a little more robust and what does it really do for us and me and whatnot? Well, and that's fine. Those are good questions, right? Not all of us are as quickly inclined to warm and fuzzy feelings and imagery as some of the rest of us, like myself. But so here we turn to the legendary authoritative Mayo Clinic, all right? And in this article where they suggest that our very health, that your individual very health is tied to how actively you roll your sleeves up and volunteer to get stuff done in community. And the Mayo Clinic in this article, they provide six health benefits. I'm just going to quickly roll through these, found in community participation and in volunteering. One, community participation and volunteering, it decreases the risk of depression. Woo! All right, no time for taboo, right? Real talk, that's what time it's for. I'll tell you, honestly, transparently, I can really benefit from that. Honestly, if there's one thing that I can benefit from, if I only need one excuse to come and participate more fully in community, it's to help my damn depression, all right? So yeah, transparency, vulnerability, that's good. That's community. That's us, all right? Two, participation in community, volunteering, gives a sense of purpose, teaches valuable skills. Maybe those are things we're not so surprised by. Number three, participation in community and volunteering may enhance a person's social networks so that to buffer stress and to reduce the risk of disease. Think through just for a quick moment all the things we do in life to reduce the risk of disease. We eat different, we exercise different, or at least think about it every once in a while. All of these things, on and on and on and on, we do in an effort to reduce the risk of disease. Well, here, one thing we can do, Mayo Clinic is telling us, is to simply get more involved in your community. Like, that's powerful stuff. Four, may reduce stress levels. Kind of sounds similar to buffer stress in the last one, but specifically to reduce stress levels, and it goes on, volunteering helps people stay physically and mentally active, thereby reducing their stress levels. Five now. This one, woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Community participation and volunteering may help you live longer. So, now with that, we might say, well, I'm not so sure I want to live longer, all right? But listen, if it's also reducing our stress, reducing our depression, reducing our isolation, reducing our risk of disease, and adding to our happiness, which as you look at, I would have loved to take more time if we could, maybe in another time, delve more blue skies of happiness. He lives right here in the Twin Cities. But so delve more into his work and happiness and the connectivity with measurable peer-reviewed social scientists, what their findings are on happiness gain, tying that specifically to how active you are in your community and volunteering. You add all that stuff together, and yeah, then maybe I wouldn't mind living a little longer too, right? Let's do it. Okay, number six then. Well, actually with number five here, so I want to consider this. It says, continuing with the live longer thought, says, quote, an analysis of data from the longitudinal study of aging found that individuals who volunteer have lower mortality rates than those who do not, even when controlling for age, gender, physical health. In addition, several studies have shown that volunteers with chronic or serious illness experience declines in pain intensity physically, as well as declines in depression emotionally and mentally when serving as volunteers to their peers. And then lastly, number six, this one's maybe a little less surprising once again. Volunteering helps you meet others, develop new relationships, thereby decreasing your sense of isolation. Absolutely. Woo woo everyone, okay? The simple conclusion here then is that our community participation, our initiative taking, our volunteering, it is tied to our very health and well-being. And yet, the benefits extend far beyond merely to the individual doing the volunteering, don't they? You see, the cool thing is that since life has built each and every one of us with a slightly different mix of skills, interests, passions, experiences, perspectives, etc., 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 because we all have been built by life with a slightly different mix of each of these things, because of that, that means we each bring something to the community that is at least slightly different from that which anyone else in the entire community is even able to contribute. So our increased participation is not only better for my own personal health, it's better for the development of everyone else in the community. And the more we're each playing our role, the more we're each putting our hands together, the more we're each taking jackets off and rolling up sleeves, putting our hands together to get work done. The more we do this, and the more we do this together, the more the work is more evenly spread out, the more it's more evenly distributed. And real talk, the less tempted others are by the feeling that they have to overwork themselves for the rest of the community. Because we see you as well. And by no means are we saying that even those who are overworking themselves for the sake of the community, almost against their own sense of sanity, that's not to say you have to do more. Maybe it's the rest of us need to step up in community and alleviate you a little bit. But what is all of this? This brings all of our role to the forefront in this. And so I ask us, each of us, all of us, for the sake of our own good and for that of the entire community, as well as for all the communities of which we serve, how might we upgrade our participation? If I were to ask you to take a couple moments to consider, which by the way I am, if I were to ask you to take a couple moments to consider where your passions lie and how you might more fully activate those passions around right here, around the society, the FUS community, what might you write down? Go ahead, take a moment, consider that, and even consider actually writing it if you'd like. But take a moment, consider that. If by chance we're not so sure exactly where we could put those things to use, here is merely a sampling. Guess what? I just so happen to have such a sampling with me of some various possibilities, all right? Some of the most pressing issues as I've done my research, okay? Social media and tech, all right? Some of us, we love playing on social media all day. Well, we could put that to good use towards the community. The online community stretching all the way around the whole globe. Children's education, teens' education, moving toward equity team, right? Are your interests in diversity and inclusion? How might we work together in that? Climate justice team, okay? As the world literally is burning down, how can we, might we stop it? Working towards climate justice. The caring circle. Maybe you've been at a point in your life where you know others where they were ill and you've seen or experienced how wonderful it was to have someone reach out and keep in touch. That is the caring circle. All right, job assistance, job search assistance, right? How many of us have been in need of that, benefited from it, and now have experiences to contribute towards the community? Auction and fundraising, this stuff doesn't pay for itself, right? And we know that, and we give towards it. But we also, that reserve, that fuel to keep everything funding above and beyond. Seasonal celebrations, helping our holidays come alive through the experiences our incredible team provides. Library and bookstore, history and archives, hospitality, greeters and ushers, welcoming, wonderful. The opportunities are virtually endless. And music, you're right, Barb, another pressing issue. Yes, so many of these, and these are merely some of the highlights as I asked around. Now, whether it's pitching in on an official team or simply finding little ways that you can just work your way in to elevate the humanist community around us, whether it's looking for whole new opportunities or bringing a rejuvenated focus to the work you're already doing, may we each look for how we might participate in the community around us. How we might be and more fully become the humanist community that we each and the entire world so desperately need. In the year 1979, Indian environmental activist Jadhav Pine was still only a teenager. And as a teenager in India, living on Majuli, the world's largest river island, Jadhav realized that on parts of the island, soil erosion was so bad that plant life literally could not grow and sustain itself. But Jadev realized that by planting and carefully tending to just one tree at a time, just one tree at a time, he could cultivate a more hospitable, ecologically robust environment. And so Jadev, as a teenager in 1979, started doing that very thing. Every single day, he planted a new tree, a sapling here, a sapling there, one tree at a time, one day at a time. And slowly but surely, that tiny cluster of trees grew to a slightly larger cluster of trees, and then a slightly larger cluster of trees. And as the cluster kept growing, the habitat grew healthier and more robust. Soon there was a lush forest floor filled with grass and brush. Soon all sorts of animals were meandering their way into this Jadev-produced forest, okay? Yes, even elephants and even tigers. I've seen the documentary. You can too, okay? And over the decades, that tiny cluster of trees transformed into a forest that is now today nearly double the size of New York City's Central Park. A thriving oasis that, yes, Jadev, even today, continues to expand one tree, one day at a time, even as it yet remains completely surrounded by desert. And so here we are, tending to this tree of community out in the desert. The tree of community that we're tending to, once again, isn't the top-down hierarchical kind of tree. It's the we're all in this together, so let's stretch and interweave our branches kind of tree. It's the let's interweave our branches and upgrade our participation kind of tree. It's that kind of tree. We're that kind of community. The kind where the increased participation benefits ourselves, our heart health, our mental health, our not so isolated health. It's the kind of community where we benefit even as we share that benefit with everyone else around us. Sharing our unique mix of those strengths, skills, interests, passions, perspectives, right? And on and on and on. And actually caring as we do so. Actually caring as we share our time and attention and as we invest our participation in those around us. Kind of a beautiful thing, really. Incredibly beautiful and powerful and sort of definitively humanist. The only question is how will this increased participation unfold among us? And how will it begin with you? Thank you.
Thank you. warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. All of these we carry in our hearts and in our minds until we are together again.
I think we're all ready to roll up our sleeves here, huh? My closing words are from Maya Angelou, her poem, Continue. My wish for you is that you continue. Continue to be who and how you are, to astonish a mean world with your acts of kindness. Continue to dare to love deeply and risk everything for the good thing. Continue to float happily in the sea of infinite substance, which set aside riches for you before you had a name. Continue, so may it be.
Thanks, everybody.